Hey everyone, my name is Manik Madaan, and in this video I'm going to break down my life as a resident doctor in America. First I'm going to break down my first year timeline. So right now I'm in my PGY-1 year of residency in psychiatry, and like the way my residency is oriented is the first 6 months are non-psych rotations, and the next 6 months that I'll go through will be psych rotations. And the reason we're given like this 6 months of non-psych rotations is to get a holistic understanding of medicine, because that will in a way complement our psychiatric understanding of whatever is happening. For 6 months, I have 2 months of neuro rotations, which I just got done with. Then like I'm gonna start my emergency medicine rotation tomorrow. And after that, like starts my 3 months of internal medicine, which I'll do at a different hospital. And after this, it's like consult liaison psychiatry for me, 1 month of that, and 5 months of inpatient psychiatry. So that's my first year timeline for you. How about my timings? So I would say I'm living a really good life right now. So I'm doing my neuro rotation, and I get like 2 days off, which is the week. So I get the weekend off in neuro. So I have 2 days off, and that time I have to chill and relax and just to keep my mental health at its peak. So Saturday, Sunday is off, right? So Monday to Friday is the time that I work, and my work timings go from like my work starts at 8 and it goes till 4:30 to 5 mostly, but sometimes it even ends at 4. There have been times when I've stayed in the hospital till 7. But like that was very, very unusual because the attending was busy with some. So we were waiting for the attending and it would take time to see the patients. It would go till 7, like to even document like it in the EMR. So it took time, but that was a very rare, happened like I think once or twice at max. My Thursdays are an exception because Thursdays are dedicated to didactics, which is just for psychiatry. And we get like half a day, like from 8 till about 1:30 to learn, to get lectures about psychiatry. This also includes grand rounds where like leaders from all around America in psychiatry teach us and give us education on what's been happening in the cutting edge of psych. After this, like it was just my new rotation. Now like getting into all the nits and grits of my usual days, let's say a Monday. So a typical Monday looks like, what happens is from 8 to 8:30 we have this thing called morning report. And in morning report, what we do is a person who has like, we discuss cases. So there's this big television in the middle, like this big screen, and you can project to the screen and you can discuss patients. For example, if somebody had epilepsy and they had temporal lobe sclerosis or mesial sclerosis, you can actually see that in the MRI and you can get different views in that big screen. And the person there will explain to you what's been happening with them, what's the history, what medications they are on, what was the treatment plan, and how did we manage the case, which is like really, really helpful to give you insight into different kinds of cases. And that is one of the best times I enjoy in neurology. After like 8:30 to 12, I round on my patients. So I normally handle about 3 to 4 patients a day. And the reason for this is I'm just an intern, I've just started. So this is part of the like kind of the workload isn't too much on me because I'm just in that phase of learning. So I take my time with patients. I round on 3 to 4 patients max a day, and like at 12 by myself. So during this time, I also use the EMRs to go over the patient notes from different departments. For example, let's say if I'm working neuro and the patients are admitted under the ortho service, I go through the like what's been happening through the ortho progress notes. What do they think, what's been happening with the patient? Then what does medicine think, or what does psych think? So you get this multidisciplinary thing in the morning, and you go through what's been happening with the patient, and you see the timeline of when they were admitted to where they are now, which gives you like a very holistic picture of what you're gonna see today and how are you gonna manage it. Adds so much detail to the whole picture and like gives you so much data on how to manage the patient, which is crucial I think for helping patients. And after that there's lunch period where like 12 to 1 we get lunch, as well as there's a didactics in neuro which we attend, and it's kind of fun, like you eat lunch while like watching lectures. I mean, that's a very nerdy medical thing, but yep, that's a good time to relax and just learn. After 1, we round on patients a lot of the times with our attendings. This can even happen, the rounding on patients with the attending can happen before 12 also if the attendings get free early and we get free early. But however, most of the case, more often than not, we tend to round up on our patients from 1 to 4, and like then, like depending upon when the rounds finish, I document the cases in my EMR, make notes of everything what's been going on with the management plan and whatnot. So now I'm gonna talk to you about my understanding of the level of care of the US medical system 2 months into it right now. So the first thing is, like, the US medical system is multidisciplinary in nature, and the way I can explain that is in terms of cases. For example, so we had a patient who tried to commit suicide by overdosing on a certain anti-epileptic pill, and as well as trying to hurt themselves. So there was a lot of bleeding because they tried to hurt themselves. So this patient was brought into the ED, trauma surgery admitted to them, and after they admitted them, they operated on the patient. And once that patient was stable, we saw the patient and we found out what they had OD'd on. We managed the patient by managing different types of medications based on like, okay, what this patient was taking in at home, and changing that to what we thought would be okay. Because if a patient had OD'd on a certain anti-epileptic pill and it could be lethal to their life, we discontinue that and go on to something that's more non-lethal, and that's what we did in the end. So also there was psych who was consulted on this, because this patient had tried to commit suicide and this patient ended up getting voluntary admission. So you could see that there were at least three specialties here, like trauma surgery, neuro and psych, who were like taking care of the patient. So you get this multidisciplinary approach, like by experts, to treat patients, which I think is so very rare in a medical system, and it's so special. Like, it's also very interesting, and that's my second point, is the electronic medical record system. So we have two types of EMRs. We have Cerner at like the neurology service, but in the psych service we have Epic. And an interesting thing happens with these EMR systems that a lot of people just don't take into account. So in an EMR system, you get the whole picture of what is really happening with the patient. For example, like regarding like that patient, he was admitted to trauma surgery. So trauma surgery had their own notes about the patient in the EMR, which I went through. Then psych had their own notes about the patient, what they thought, like he had also had depression, by the way. So they had thoughts about what they thought like he needed, if he needed any involuntary admission, voluntary admission, or any changes in medication. So I went even over that. And then what you also get is their labs a lot of the times get updated regularly or R2R based, and even their BP, their heart rate, oxygenation, you get the whole picture, right? And it happens in real time in EMR. So you get access to these multiple varieties of medicine, multiple specialty data, as well as you get data from different levels of healthcare providers, starting from nurses to PTOT, which is outpatient therapy and physical therapy, to like advanced specialties or primary care specialists. You also can get data from example radiology. For example, if this patient had like some issue in his arms, like because he tried to hurt himself, they would also get an x-ray, and we get to go over that x-ray. So you're getting this neural net of what every expert thinks in their field, and you get to see the whole picture, which I think is so valuable in medicine. Now you can also do what is, you can actually separate patient data, like patient identifiers, from this data and conduct research on multiple patients who are undergoing a similar comorbidity, which facilitates research. The next thing I love about the US healthcare system is how patient oriented it is. Since I was just like seeing 3 to 4 patients a day, and at max, if I were like a senior, I would be seeing at a max, I think 10 to 20 patients at max. Even if that was true, I can give so much of time to my patients. I mean, like right now I was spending about 30 minutes. Like 15 to 30 minutes on a patient, sometimes even an hour. And I think that amount of time gave me enough room for a good conversation, a room for connection, a room for the patient to share any concern that they had, which says 1,000 words about like the healthcare system here. Because what does a patient a lot of times need is, they need a person to talk to, and if you're there, it helps a lot. So we have a state-of-the-art faculty here at my hospital for everything. If you go to patient rooms, a lot of them are like at the level of 5 stars. If you like, you look at the rooms, they're so pleasant. We have treatments that like are cutting edge in their domains. For example, if a person has Parkinson's, we can give them DBS here. DBS is deep brain stimulation, which we use to stimulate subcortical parts of the brain so that the patient can improve. So we do that for Parkinson's, and then like we do it for other disorders too, like depression. Then we have TMS for depression, transcranial magnetic stimulation. We have reverse TMS. There's vagal nerve stimulation, VNS, for epilepsy, which like what happens is, for example, if you have a defibrillator, for you would know that if your heart has a fibrillation or arrhythmia, there comes defibrillators which can stabilize the arrhythmia and demolish that arrhythmia. We have a similar thing for epilepsy, which is called as VNS or vagal nerve stimulator. For example, if you have epilepsy coming from your right parietal lobe, we can use a VNS to reverse that flow of charge, to cancel that flow of charge, which is really, really useful for epilepsy and is cutting edge. We have sleep medicine. Whatever you can think of, the most level of advanced care, I get to see it, and I get to learn from people who are at the top. I do not mean just like the top, like in a rhetorical term or just like because I want to say it, but I seriously mean it. We learn from the people who are making these therapies. We learn from people who are actually at like the top of their fields. For example, one of the attendings I was working in neurology with, she got a $1.6 million funding to research the effects of COVID on the brain, like, and the late sequelae of what happens in COVID. So that's huge, right? Like, you're learning from people who are really developing that specialty, who are at the cutting edge of the specialty, who are leaders in their fields, which will later transform you into like somewhat at their level or just below their level, which is, and what happens a lot of the time is like in India, I remember like all the PGs used to learn from books. Here, it's not very much like that. People actually end up learning way more from their professors because they are way more oriented to what the latest research is in, and they have the most up-to-date knowledge there, rather than a book, which sometimes is not even updated, and plus does not have any context or like regional context or what's happening in that certain community that can help the patients more. Next on, we also have up-to-date subscriptions. So a lot of people here don't learn from books, they learn from up-to-date, like which has the research data on a certain condition, such as migraines. We've done that. So Manik, how does staff behave with the rest of residents as well as students? So interestingly enough, like what you will see here is there's not much of a solid hierarchy structure, which we see in other countries, such as where like the top, like the head of the faculty would dominate over every other person. And there's like this like levels in healthcare where like somebody would boss somebody around. It's not very much like that, but rather what you would feel is, yes, there is that hierarchy, like in terms of positions and in terms of structure. However, people are way more friendlier here. Like my attendings sometimes treat me as like, you know, a friend, or rather somebody like they're teaching, and they like even the feedback that you get. For example, if there's some harsh feedback that they have to deliver to you, and if you did something wrong, they would not scrutinize you in front of every other student. They would take you out personally somewhere and discuss it with you one-on-one, and not really make you feel bad or make you feel that you're incompetent, but rather give you honest advice and like try to make you improve in those levels. And like the whole residency programs like here feel like much of a family. So if you look at the seniority level, PGY-1, PGY-2, PGY-3, PGY-4, you would not actually see that like in interactions as if like, you know, somebody's dominating over somebody. No, that doesn't happen here. It's more of like everybody's a friend, everybody's family. You talk with them with care, with love, with respect. And I've never ever myself gotten disrespect from anyone here. And they've always treated me like family with love and care. And I'm so thankful. Now, jumping onto salary, which I know a lot of you would have been want to know about. So my salary here, so I get my salary bi-weekly, and my salary ends up being somewhere at like $2,460 bi-weekly. So in total that would be like how much, $4,920 per month. This is again before taxes. After taxes, like, you get 23% of a tax cut, and I think it becomes about $3,900 per month, which I think is more than enough for my expenses. For example, I'm just paying, sharing this apartment right now with my roommate, and I just pay $550 for rent. I have this big room, big ass room, like, it's a big apartment. Like, we have our own lobby, we have like a big kitchen, everything you can think of. It's super safe, centrally air conditioned. What else do I need? Then, like, utilities are not that costly. Electricity plus internet costs me about at like $100 max, including water and whatnot, right? So that's taken care of. So I don't really spend a lot on living. I also right now don't have a car, so I don't spend on that. But yeah, there's not a lot of expenses on food. I think I spent $600. So in total, my spendings are somewhere at like $1,200 per month. So that's about $2,600 of savings every single month after taxes, if you like think of a salary like that. So that is like, I'm saving $2,600. All of these goes into like my savings, my stocks, which I invest into, which I think will compound over time. So it's, I'm living a pretty comfortable life, my friend. We also get other benefits. So like in PGY-1, I get $550 of CME money towards buying, let's say, any educational material. For example, I can buy an iPad, a laptop, which the institution pays for. I can also put that money towards my exams, for example, USMLE Step 3, which a lot of people do. You can also use it for buying textbooks, or let's say if you want to buy like a stethoscope, a Littmann stethoscope, or some kind of neurological equipment, which a lot of people buy in the neurology program, for example, a tuning fork, a reflex hammer. Even though how expensive it is, the university will pay for it. There's also meal money that we get. We get $150 per quarter. So $150 every 3 months. So in a year, that's $450 per yearly, right? Which is good money if you want to eat. The cafeteria, I mean, I do fall a bit short of it. Like, cause let's say if I were eating every day in the cafeteria and I'm spending, let's say $7, that comes to about $210 in a month, which like, so this money doesn't cover my food expenses. But again, I'm more than happy with what I'm getting. I'm getting some free food. That's what I need to survive. There's also tons of events that happen here. Like, for example, GME recently conducted a GME Wellness Day where we got like free food coupons. I got like $10 worth of free food. We got tons of gifts. So you can see I got like a journal, right, to write down my feelings, and like it's a gratitude journal. Start where you are. So that's great. And then a prayer book. So I also got a first aid kit. This is a mini first aid kit, if you can see. Tons of La Roche products, lip balm, and we also got skipping ropes to like take care of ourselves. We also have free therapy sessions we get here if you want, like, for our mental health, with licensed professionals who are psychologists. So that's great. Next, moving on to like what were the difficulties that I felt here. So the first thing was just getting oriented to the whole healthcare system, which is like a bit more streamlined and complex compared to where I'm coming from. There's the EMR system, electronic medical record system, which I was like oblivious to yet, and I was like, how does Cerner work? I had no clue. So thank you to neurology department who taught me, like, went me, like, made me go from a rookie level to an intermediate level at how Cerner works. I still don't know a lot of technicalities of it, but I'm learning. I'm getting better every single day. Second issue that I had in America was I had no credit because I'm coming from a foreign country. And if you have no credit, the issue is you can't buy a lot of things. For example, if I want to get a car, it's $24,000. And if I don't have that money upfront, I have to take a loan. And the loan gets more expensive as, like, if you have no credit. I had to pay like a 6% to 12% interest, which is very high. But if you have a credit, that goes to 1% or 2%. So even taking a loan is really hard. So many companies won't even give you a loan just because you don't have a credit history, which really gets on my nerves. But yeah, I'm going to buy a car soon. In cash, I know, which is crazy, but you know, like, having no car here is probably one of the worst things like you can do, because in Hershey, where I'm living, everything is so far away. And if you don't have a car, you're basically dead. Like, I do not kid you. Without a car, you cannot survive in Hershey. The last thing I would say is I actually felt like, even though there was a slight learning curve, everybody was so supportive, so nice, and so kind-hearted that they took me under their wing, didn't get angry on me, even though I can act like a fool sometimes, but they loved me. And they saw me as a person who could improve and made me get better. Thank you to all of you for watching. If you liked it, please like and subscribe.